That's a female human ovulating. We had never before seen it. That's phenomenal to me. Thank you. I couldn't have done that any better myself. I owe you a grand debt. This happened entirely coincidentally. This was a woman who was having a hysterectomy, and while she was on the table and surgery was in progress, you can see there's actually a surgical instrument that's noted there, you know. They were actually in the process of doing a hysterectomy. The attending surgeon realized that this woman was beginning to ovulate, and he stopped the surgery for a few minutes to actually record what was happening, because we had never seen this before. So what's your concept of ovulation? What do you think ovulation is like? What happens at that level? Do you have this concept of, you know, this egg bursting forth, right? Isn't that sort of the concept that we hear and we grow up thinking and we learn about, you know, this explosive event when it ruptures and, you know, here comes this egg. If you read the accounts that this gentleman, I can't say the name because I don't speak French. Does anybody know? Jacques Donnez. If you read the accounts that he published about this, he said, you know, I was stunned. It was sort of like this slowly oozing thing that, you know, took a while to happen.
There's video. I'll give you the video.
You have the video. Okay. So I just find this phenomenal that in something as important as actual ovulation itself, it's not until 2008 that we get to that. So menopause is about ovulating. It's about reproducing, and it's a huge evolutionary puzzle. What we're going to do is we're going to walk through a couple of the fairly common arguments about menopause, extended lifespan model, and I'll tell you what that is in a minute, and the grandmother hypothesis, and I'll tell you what that is in a minute. And you guys are going to help me, we're going to help each other think critically about the implications of each of those models, and is there evidence or isn't there? What would the world look like if one of those models were correct or the other were correct or whatever? Okay. Because it's important for you to get the logical understanding behind these, right? You need to be able to recognize when a model makes sense or doesn't make sense, when you think it's coherent, logical, critically sound, and when it's not, right? That's how you get to be a good evolutionist. That's what we want you to go away with. Then we're going to talk about another model that might or might not be right, that's really new, and that a lot of people in this room have never heard of before, okay? And see where that gets us. Okay, so menopause, huge evolutionary puzzle, right? Presumably, if women could continue reproducing until the end of their lifespan, they could produce more children, have higher reproductive success. That's a great evolutionary thing, right? Yeah, it's hard, no matter where I stand. I think I'm in the middle for somebody. But female reproductive ability ceases. It ceases catastrophically. Okay, the big question is why? Now, what I want you to think about, because we have a lot of clinicians in the room, this is an important distinction. It's not menopause that's the problem from an evolutionary perspective. Menopause is a clinical syndrome, if you will, right? It's how women experience symptoms and issues and problems related to the cessation of reproductive ability. Right? The issue clinically is how do we treat this? What do we have to do? This is a critically important rearrangement of a female's physiology and endocrinology, and there are all sorts of repercussions of that, and we need to do something about it, or do we? But in either case, that's a clinical issue, right? That clinical syndrome may or may not appear, say, in other organisms. The big question is, why do we have life beyond the point at which we are capable of reproducing? Okay? That's the critical question. Remember, bodies are lifeboats. The job is to get the genes from there to there, right? In Peter's parlance, the job of life is to take energy and make new organisms. if you can't make new organisms, life shouldn't exist. Evolutionarily, it shouldn't exist. So how is it evolutionarily that as a species we are characterized by a trait that shuts off the ability to reproduce in half of the species, right? In fact, the reproduction limiting half of the species, access to female reproductive ability, limits male reproductive behavior and reproduction just like it limits female reproduction, right? How can that possibly be? So it's a subtle shift, but it's an important one, right? We're not talking about the clinical syndrome. We're talking about the phenomenon of post-reproductive life, and how could that be?
Chris, for most of human history, that didn't happen. I mean,
I'm going to get to that.
Okay.
I'm going to take you straight to it because that's really important. Okay. All right. So post-reproductive lifespan is really what we're interested in trying to figure out. Okay. All right. Now this is going to be really controversial. Okay. Anthropologists particularly will tell you this is unique to humans. Humans are the only species that have this. Okay? In recent years, there is growing evidence. It is not perfect, I grant you that, but there is growing evidence that at least 99% of mammals and possibly representatives of other groups as well have post-reproductive life. Okay? Do they have menopause? Well, I don't know because you can't ask them if they're having a hot flash. You can't ask them if they're cranky. You can't ask them if their sex drive went down, right? So I don't know if they have menopause, but I do know that they have post-reproductive life. Okay? So it's in, you know, all of these different organisms. I've got a list here of literature, and I can show that to you. By the way, there's a paper that I wrote that details all of this. And you have it in your course materials already if you're interested in all of those details. Okay, so this is not unique to humans, which begins to address your question, right? Okay. So let's talk about the first argument. And by the way, we'll come back to your issue again. Let's talk about the first argument. Okay, there's an argument out there that menopause is just a byproduct of these artificially inflated lifespans that humans have in, you know, this most recent century, maybe a little bit of the previous century, as lifespan started getting bigger and bigger, you know, look, reproduction just couldn't keep up. Reproductive capability just couldn't handle it, right? Okay. This I lifted out of one of Sue Margulis's presentations, looking at declines over the lifespan, percent maximal function, so declines in various bodily systems in humans, cardiac system, breathing capacity, renal plasma flow, things like that. You see all these really nice mild declines as people age, right? This is what we call senescence. This is reproduction in females, reproductive capability. Entirely different curve. This is not a subset of general senescence, okay? It is absolutely not a subset of general senescence. And as a result of this catastrophic cessation, we end up with about a third of our lifespan being post-reproductive as modern humans. Okay? In other organisms, by the way, it's not a third of the lifespan. No other organism has post-reproductive life as long or proportionately as long as humans do. It's much smaller proportions, but it's still there. Okay? So again, we may be on that the way extreme of a norm of reaction here. Okay. Actually, I want to go back one. So what I want to ask you before I move on to the next slide is this a reasonable argument? You've been hearing evolutionary arguments now for a while. I want you to answer some questions for me that will allow us to together decide if we think this is a plausible explanation, okay? So what prediction would extended lifespans argument make across species?
Not
Yes.
Some species have really long lifespans.
Mm-hmm.
Especially kind of like the ones that don't have a lot of external predators or something like sea turtles.
Okay.
And you would expect the same sort of curve.
Okay, I want to know what kind of prediction the extended lifespan model would make in terms of cross-species comparisons.
Can you summarize the sentence, the extended lifespan model?
Lifespan? The average...
Not life expectancy, is it?
You could consider it actually either way. It would work. Use life expectancy or lifespan.
Okay. 100 years ago, life expectancy was 50 or 60, mm-hmm. but some people lived to be 120.
Yes.
Now it's 80, and some people live to be 120. So are we talking about when people die?
Right.
Or when the oldest people die?
That's actually very critical, right?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. The fact that, I was going to save this for later, but the fact that average life expectancy was lower does not mean that no one survived to old age, right? When we look across species, what would we expect?
Then you wouldn't see it in any species where the life was not artificially extended.
Thank you. You wouldn't expect to see it in just about any other animal, right? Because they don't have, automobiles. They don't have, all of this big cultural development and medical intervention and preventive medicine and things that have extended their lifespans, right? So unless you've seen a very recent expansion in the lifespan in a species, you would not expect to see menopause, if this is true. Okay? Zoos are interesting, right? You might expect to see it in zoos because they're artificially keeping animals alive to longer stages, later stages in life. Right? Highly domesticated.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. So these are exactly the kinds of arguments that I expect, right? That's the logic I expect to see. But that slide I just showed you a minute ago contradicts that, doesn't it? If post-reproductive life exists in all these other organisms that don't have recent expansions in their lifespan, we have a problem, right? What about across bodily systems? If the post-reproductive lifespan is simply a product of these modern expansions in life, right? What do we make of that graph, right? Why is it that only reproductive ability couldn't keep up with those lifespans and everything else could? I mean, reproduction is the vehicle to get that energy into those babies, to get those genes from there to there, right? Wouldn't you think that, just about anything else would be thrown away or compromised to protect this evolutionarily? If this is how you get those genes, if you increase this and you have a chance for one more offspring, two more offspring, right? That should override all of these systems. We should let some of these go a little bit, let these senesce faster to hang on to that, right? So we have an issue on that level with this kind of argument. Okay. What kind of prediction, think about the cross-species prediction, what kind of prediction do you make about gender? If modern changes in the lifespan, modern technological advances, expanding the lifespan is all that's going on here, what do you predict about gender? Yeah. Look, if reproductive ability can't keep up with these extended lifespans, well, then I expect that means reproductive ability can't keep up, and that means men and women,
except,
right?
Except
Yeah.
All the other organs have got to be working pretty well to make that energetic investment. It's orders of magnitude higher than what men invest energetically. And so that's one reason for the dimorphism between genders.
Okay. So you might say that explains some of it, but I would still expect that this would be much similar, or that males would be down here a little bit, right? I wouldn't expect a complete absence of this phenomenon in one gender and presence of it in the other, right? There are differences between genders, particularly energetically in terms of reproducing, right? But that kind of difference, right? Male reproductive ability, Senescence is up here with all of these other functions. Okay? Males basically maintain the ability, even though it's not often realized, they have the ability to continue reproducing throughout life. Okay? Yes?
Well, I'm sure you have an answer for this. There's a major difference in the setup for generation of gametes in males and females.
There sure is, and that's really important. Can I hold that?
Sure.
Okay. Okay, what does this apply over the sweep of time, extended human lifespans? If it's a product of recent modern technology and expansion in the life that's artificial, what does it apply going backwards over time? So we didn't used to have menopause, is the argument, right? Yeah.
If the average age of death is 35, well, you've only got a few percent. The probability that you'll experience menopause will change over time.
Right. Okay. But as we said, the fact that average life expectancy, when you hear those numbers, that's expectancy at birth. It does not mean that no one survived past that age, right? So lots of individuals are surviving past that age. If you look at paleodemographic data, there is a dearth of skeletons that appear to be elderly from ancestral populations. Okay? Does that mean that there were no elderly individuals in those populations? I don't think it does, right? First, there's a question about calcification levels in elderly bone and whether they would actually fossilize in the same ways that younger bone does, and that therefore we may not be finding the remains, right? They may degrade and not be findable. There simply also may not have been as many elderly individuals as there were younger, right? So death rates at younger ages may be high, and we have many of those skeletons. There would have been fewer elderly, so the probability of finding those remains may be lower, okay? So on multiple fronts, we can sort of break that one down. What I want to suggest after this big discussion is that extended lifespans don't really seem to be causal of this phenomenon, right? It seems to be refuted by the animal literature. Their animal lives aren't being extended, at least not animals in the wild, but they exhibit post-reproductive life. Other somatic systems can be extended to match this extending lifespan. There's no reason to think that reproductive systems would be incapable of being moved. In fact, you would think they would be the first system that would be dragged evolutionarily. If there was any variation in that reproductive span, right, such that some individuals were capable of reproducing for longer periods of time, it would immediately be seized on by evolution and spread, and there would be directional selection moving that. Okay? So that's a problem. The fact that it only happens in females is a problem with this model. I would expect to see males as well. We're not really sure that it's modern. It may actually have much deeper roots than that. Fertility starts falling off by 40, so even if lifespans were shorter, we start having the early stages of lower fecundity by age 40, 38, 40. And the extended modern lifespan might extend post-reproductive life, right? Put us way out as an outlier on that curve, but it's not causing it. It doesn't make logical sense that just this expansion in our lifespan forces only female and only the reproductive system to catastrophically fail 2/3 of the way through life. Okay. The next hypothesis, I'm going to call it the grandmother hypothesis and lump it all into one. The argument is, now remember yesterday I talked to you about kin selection as my sort of core
I'm not going to be able to do that.
What about grandma? We've gone through a whole bunch of issues related to this. And I think there are big problems, right? To get the initial appearance, the initial evolutionary appearance, and then spread of a strategy like this, right? So that it's going to take over the whole human species, we need to get over all of these problems related to extramarital sex, residence patterns, right? This is just tremendously complicated. It seems, if you mathematically model this, and actually it was done all the way back in 91 and 93, looking at actual data from real populations where they were measuring influence of grandmothers on various kin and things like that. If you actually do the math, it's really hard to get this model to work in a way that the benefit actually does override the cost, the potential cost. Okay? The benefits you get through kin don't exceed the potential of continuing to reproduce yourself. The benefits depend on sociality, proximity to grandchildren, residence, extramarital sex. It's not supported well by data from non-human organisms. Again, what about that cross-species thing? What sorts of residence patterns and inheritance patterns do they have? And do grandmothers in other species actually do anything for their offspring? Right? Well, in some species they do and in others they don't. But we would expect that you would see this grandmothering behavior in all other species that have post-reproductive life if this were a correct explanation. And we don't see that. All right. Now, there's a really important message I still want you to get from Grandma here. Okay? Once post-reproductive life is established as the characteristic trait in a species, once that's imposed, we absolutely expect to see individuals behaving in accordance with kin selection. Okay? I am a human female. I belong to a species characterized by menopause. It will happen to me someday. It is happening to me, unfortunately. Okay? Not a fun thing. I don't have a choice of being able to turn that off and just keep reproducing. Okay? I can't do that. So what do I do in the face of that limitation? Well, I'm going to be a really good grandma. Okay? I'm going to behave in accordance with the rules of kin selection and do everything I can once I know, once I'm in a position where I can't reproduce through my own lineage directly, that I will do everything possible to maximize my inclusive fitness through my kin. Okay? So what I'm saying to you, and you do see modest gains through these sorts of kin selection effects. Okay, it's been studied, you know, a whole lot in various populations all over the world. Okay, you do see modest evolutionary gains from grandmothering. You don't see enough to offset what an individual could do directly, however. All right? So what I want you to take home from this is that grandmothering is compatible with the existence of post-reproductive life and menopause, but it can't be causal. All right? Okay, so back to a big theoretical point. Both of these arguments I showed you were thinking about menopause as something that happens to an individual, a whole body, okay? Usually it's the case that what's in the best interest evolutionarily of the whole body is also what's in the best interest of the genes in that body. But there are times when that's not true, when what's in the best interest of the gene is different than what's in the best interest of the body. And in those cases, which one wins evolutionarily? The gene. What's in the best interest of the gene wins, okay? It's why our bodies fail, right? We do what's in the best interest of the genes, okay? At approximate level, at a mechanistic level, what seems to clinically cause cessation of reproductive ability is that females literally run out of eggs. There are too few left in the ovaries to generate the hormonal sufficiency necessary to continue cycling, okay, and ovulation. So why do we run out of eggs? Well, just logically thinking, there are two possible ways you run out of eggs. You either aren't making enough to start with, or you're losing too many of them along the way. So you're running out faster than the point at which you die, right? So can we separate those things? Well, let's talk about increasing the baseline. Theoretically, you could forestall depletion, allowing females to continue reproducing, right? If there were some normal distribution, some, you know, theoretical general normal distribution of number of gametes that females are born with, and women at the high end could continue reproducing longer because they had more eggs in their store, right? Then these women would be out reproducing those women, and you would see the frequency distribution shift to the right in a directional selection process. It would drive baseline number of gametes higher and higher and higher, right? That's the kind of thing I would imagine, like with the extended lifespan model, right? Males, for some reason, can keep reproducing. Now I know they have continuous oogenesis, different process, right? But females, we should have been able to do this if it's just that extension of the lifespan, right? We should have been able to just start making a little more. The women who made a few more could reproduce longer, have higher fertility, and it would push this curve to the right and drive up the baseline number of gametes that characterizes females in the population. And we wouldn't have menopause. We would ovulate all the way up until the time of death, right? Okay, so has that happened? No, we have menopause. Well, wait a minute. Maybe it has kind of happened. Baseline number of gametes, right? Steve talked about this the other day. It's about 7 million. By the way, I just lifted these numbers out of a paper by Lynette Leidy where she took numbers from a whole bunch of published sources and made a nice table. Okay, 7 million. Is there any reason, I mean, is there any way conceivably that we could use 7 million eggs in our lifetime? I'm not a fish, right? I don't lay millions at a time. Something has driven that number extraordinarily high. Right? Some directional selection process has moved it. By birth, we're down to 2 million. We've lost about 5, you know, 1 to 2 million at birth. By menarche, they're now saying somewhere around 400,000. We've lost another 1.6 million or so. Okay? The loss here, I think, is well explained, that loss of gametes, by all of the filtering effects that are critical to weed out anything potentially suboptimal, given the huge energetic investment that females make in offspring, right? You can't risk ovulating an egg that'll turn into an offspring that is suboptimal. So you do your very best to throw out as many of them as you can, okay? But I want you to think about this number here, 400,000 at menarche, right? How many decades do we have, you know, of cycling? We have 400,000 eggs. We need one per cycle. Actually, we need more than that because we need other ones to generate hormonal sufficiency. Okay, but at one per cycle, oversimplifying somewhat, we could ovulate for 33,333 years at one egg per month. But we're still running out two-thirds of the way through our lives. What's happening? Where are they going? You know, in adult cycling, if these numbers are even close to right, you know, we're going through about 1,000 eggs every cycle. We're losing 1,000 eggs at every cycle. The most valuable cells in the body, from an evolutionary point of view, I like this magic word, atresia. Magic atresia, they're disappearing. Oh my God, we don't know where they're going. Something's happening to them. 1,000 per cycle. Let's step back for a minute and think about it. I'm a female. From my point of view, I look down to my ovaries. I say 50% mine, 50% mine, 50% mine, right? All of my gametes are equal evolutionarily. Assuming my filtering processes that got rid of those first 5 million are pretty darn good, right? Probabilistically, those things, all of these gametes are the same from my point of view as an individual. Okay, from the gamete's point of view, if I'm a gamete and I'm sitting next to you in an ovary, if I look across at you, evolutionarily, does it make a difference which one of us gets ovulated? It sure does to me, doesn't it? Because we are not the same. We are different, right? Not all gametes are equal from the point of view of the gamete, right? What are the possible outcomes for a gamete? Death, magic atresia, right? I can just sit here and die, or I can do things to be ovulated, right? Now, is ovulation a guarantee to getting into the next generation? Of course not. But it's the only attendant possibility for getting into the next generation, isn't it? Okay. So any gamete that could do anything that increased its chance of being ovulated would be evolutionarily favored. But what I think is that female gametes are actually competing in the ovary for chances to be ovulated, all right? And that eventually, right, so this would explain all of that magical atresia that's going on. Gametes are actually affecting the microenvironment and thereby affecting other gametes around them, right, leading to females running out of eggs, right? What that means is, if you follow that through to completion, menopause is collateral damage at the level of the individual as a result of basically a war that's going on in the ovary between gametes, okay? Now, this is the danger of a theoretician like myself digging into these things, because I'm not an endocrinologist, so Peter probably is maybe shaking his head, you know, some of these pieces need to be filled into this puzzle, okay? And it may or may not end up being correct, but it's another way to think about it. Okay, we know that within an ejaculate, co-resident sperm compete for access to eggs in various ways. Sperm are only in association with each other for a matter of days. Female gametes are in the proximity of each other for at least 15 years before first reproduction, generally, right? I would expect the evolution of some sort of competitive mechanism under those kinds of situations, right? Where am I here? So, you know, the upshot here is any gamete that's content to wait to be ovulated would be selected against, right? It seems there should be a race going on, if you will, a war going on, a competition, because chances of success getting into the next generation decrease with time, right? Chances of maternal death, uncertain futures, things like that. So we should see this sort of competition going on. Interestingly, it seems that we lose eggs at this rate whether we are actually menstruating and cycling or not. There is some literature about that, which suggests that you know, eggs are sort of blindly pushing forward, trying to get to the next generation, compromising the eggs around them, regardless of, you know, they can't know the future. They can't know if this particular cycle, when they happen to be ready, is going to be one of those cycles that Peter showed where you can actually be fecund. They don't know that, right? All they can do is keep pushing forward. And doing it faster will have a better evolutionary payoff than doing it slower. Sit in an aging ovary and wait is not a good evolutionary strategy if you're a gamete, okay? So I want to show one or two more slides quickly. I think, you know, if this is right, if this kind of conceptual thinking is right, it suggests that we need to reframe how we talk about female reproductive physiology and all of those mechanisms. We need an active framework, not a passive framework. And I'm not a huge feminist or whatever, but I think this is really important. If you go into medical books and anatomy books and biology books and things like that, we can describe the same process in different ways, the same functional phenomena that we're looking at and seeing, right? We can take a passive view, which is what, you know, 99.99% of the textbooks out there do, right? Things like the gametes undergo atresia, right? Well, if the competition model is right, they're not undergoing atresia. Gametes are having effects on the microenvironment that actively compromise the gametes next to them, right? Gametes are killing other gametes indirectly, you know, through hormonal loops and things like that, right? You hear all the time, at this stage, the follicle is rescued by the FSH surge. Rescued, it's a dainty little thing, right? It's not a dainty little thing, it's critical evolutionary material struggling in the battle for life, okay? In the more active sort of competition model, it would be something like the dominant follicle races to catch the FSH wave, right, and ensure its survival. It's the same phenomenon happening, we're just talking about it a little bit differently with a slightly different perspective. Subordinate follicles then succumb to atresia. No, they don't. The dominant follicle secretes estradiol and inhibin, reduces the FSH, and that kills the other ones. They can't continue developing under those conditions. It's a very active process, right? A dominant follicle maintains its position, and the subordinate follicles succumb, right? It continuing on for several days. Well, the dominant follicle continues to secrete those hormones to ensure that no other gamete is going to end up at the same stage and as an active competitor right at the moment of ovulation. It's a very active phenomenon.
So have they shown that these are different gametes present, which have different phenotypes?
Are there different gametes that have different phenotypes?
How is one producing, secreting estradiol not being affected by it? And the other, so are they?
Oh, because they have to get to certain stages of development to be able to withstand the microenvironmental presence of different levels of various hormones, right? So any that aren't at the appropriate stage will die in the presence of particular hormones or levels of particular hormones, okay? Okay, so there are a bunch of predictions that this kind of thinking generates. Things like species where there is a discrete phase, a discrete and limited phase of gametogenesis will exhibit menopause. If you can continue making new gametes, even if they're competing, and right, that's the condition we see for sperm in humans, they compete with each other, but you know, you can just keep making more so you don't run out. But if you have a discrete finite period of gametogenesis, I would expect to see menopause. Okay, is that borne out in the world? To the best of my knowledge, it seems to be. Fish, reptiles, amphibians are characterized by continuous gametogenesis. They do not seem to have post-reproductive life. Mammals have discrete gametogenesis. We are characterized, for the most part, by post-reproductive life. There are some interesting exceptions to that, certain prosimians. I'd like to really delve into some of those cases, but I haven't been able to do it yet. They may be the interesting exception that proves the rule, if you will. So I need to look into that a little further. Increasing the number of gametes at baseline will not proportionately extend the lifespan. What's it going to do? It just puts more competitors in the race, makes the competition tougher, right? It's not going to end up extending reproductive life. I'm looking to see if I have notes on here that are anything different. Stronger competitors we might expect may be ovulated early, right? Gametes that are particularly robust for some reason related to genes, related to any sorts of early processes, may be more successful at getting through this process, leaving behind any that may be inferior, which could then actually be driving this phenomenon that we all know so well, about the increasing incidence of birth defects and things like that later in life, right? If the ones that are the most robust or the best competitors, they get through earlier in the game, what are you left with? You're left with ones that are not as robust later on. So it may be that those sorts of phenomena are not being driven, at least not solely, by environmental insult that somehow penetrates our bodies and into our ovaries and degenerates the eggs that we have. It may just be that, you know, if you will, the losers in the bunch are left for last, right? They don't get there as quickly. Across species, you'd expect longer-lived organisms would lose gametes more slowly. Why? Because I expect this to be tracking lifespan in some way, right? How fast do I have to get there to ensure my chance to get there? What are the attendant possibilities of maternal death, things like that? And that seems to be borne out in the literature as well. There is variation in age at menopause in humans. From one culture to another, now there are issues with how you measure age at menopause. There's a huge amount of slop around the data, right? It's all retrospective, you know, yeah, when was your last period? Oh, about a year ago, yeah, somewhere around age 50, right? I mean, there's all these biases in the reporting and things like that. But there are some estimates, and they do differ markedly from one population to the other. And it turns out that if you just take, because it's the data is from many different studies with different methodologies and things, I didn't want to be too statistical with it because it wouldn't be accurate anyway, but I wanted to get an idea if there was a trend, if lifespan really, you know, menopause really seems to be tracking with lifespan. And it actually does seem that way. If you take the populations for which we have data on both age at menopause and lifespan, expected lifespan, you do a median split, take the bottom 50% of lifespan, and look at what the age at menopause is in those populations, it's about 2 years earlier than it is in the populations with the higher lifespans. Okay? So it does, there is at least some preliminary evidence that is actually real. And the other thing that I think is really interesting is that female behaviors that affect probability of death should affect age at menopause. If you look at the literature about what factors are correlated with age at menopause, actually I have a slide with this, okay? Unrelated to age at menopause, okay, or extraordinarily conflicting data in the literature suggesting that, you know, it doesn't really seem to be clear that it's there, are age of menarche, regularity of menstrual cycling, age of first birth, pregnancies, abortions, use of oral contraceptives, breastfeeding history, all these things that you think ought to track, right? But they don't seem to. What is undoubtedly and consistently and reliably documented in the literature is that lower age at menopause is strongly associated with not having children, number one. Now, what would that do in terms of a competition model? She's not getting pregnant, not getting pregnant, not getting pregnant, not getting pregnant. Fight, 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 fight harder, get there, get there, get there. We ran out, right? Okay, so that's what the kind of thing I'm imagining here for nulliparity. The other major factor is smoking, right? The number one killer and compromiser of all systems in the body, most toxic thing you can do, reliably related to lower age at menopause within populations, okay? Similarly, there is very suggestive literature, not completely substantiated yet, but very suggestive that being unmarried, low SES, high stress, and extraordinarily lean are related with lower ages of menopause. Also makes perfect, socioeconomic status. Also makes a lot of sense in this kind of model. Women who fall into those sorts of constellations of life factors, right, are at high risk of disease, of death, of all sorts of negative things that mean the reproductive system should go faster, right? So we should run out. Interestingly, Steve and some colleagues published a paper looking at Framingham data. It does seem like it's possible to see evolutionary change over short amounts of time in age at menopause, with even modern US data here. And there's a tremendous amount of cross-cultural variation that I've delved into to some extent, like I've told you, but that also is rich to still be explored in terms of this. I really have to shut up. We'll have lots of time to talk. What I'd like to do, though, is bring Jillian and Peter back up here and let you guys, because all of these topics are so related about female reproduction and reproductive life and all of those issues, that I want to open it up and give a chance for any kinds of questions that might be for this whole block panel. Okay? All right. So.